Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us for the 17th edition today for Capital Insider series. And today we are actually taking up a very interesting subject, is that today how family offices are going to be an increasing source of funding for startups, where they will come and support startups and where they'll help startups to grow. Like we've seen venture capital, we've seen angel investors. Similarly, probably in the coming years, we will see an active participation by family offices, wherein they will come forward and invest in startups. So I was reading some data regarding this, and I came across that in 2018 in India, about only 1% of the total funding came from family offices. But in coming into almost by 2020, it had reached down to a 2% situation. And of course, while the pandemic has slowed us down, but in essentially we will see a lot more participation coming from family offices as India goes digital and a lot more startups will be coming out there, particularly on the tech side of things. We will see far more funding coming probably from the family offices in the times to come. So today we have a stellar panel with whom we are going to discuss about what are the synergies that family businesses and startups can have with each other over the next 40 to 45 minutes. So we have, as I said, Rishabh Mariwala, who's the co-founder and director of Sharp Ventures. Of course, he's part of the Marico Group, the family, and Sharp Ventures itself goes out and does a lot of investing in startups themselves. So welcome, Rishabh. And let me start with you. And of course, but very quickly before that, let me also introduce Binayfar, who's joined us as from Ray Patni Family Office. Manish Randev, who is the founder and CEO of Servan Family Office, and of Rajmohan Krishna, who is the principal founder and director for the Interest Family Office. And so welcome to all of you, and we're looking forward to this wonderful talk. And I would request all our viewers to keep on asking their questions, as we will also ask our panelists to answer it for you and explain to you things which you think you still would like to know more about family office and funding for startups. So Rishabh, let me start with you. You know, as a family, when there was a time when Mariwala Group thought about, what was the time when you thought about investing in a family office and startups particularly? And given the fact that, you know, the asset class of startups is very different from all the other asset classes that exist for a family trust today to put their monies in. So what was it that triggered you to do it or invest in startups, and what kind of startups do you look forward to invest in?
Sure. No, thanks Ritu. Pleasure to be here and pleasure to connect with everybody. So I'll just share a little bit about our journey. So we started this entire journey in 2014. Our parent company, as you know, Marico, the dividend payout ratio of Marico increased. So with that, we had a constant liquidity event every year. So we had a perspective in terms of steady state of flows coming into Marico. And before this, though we would get dividend, and we had some amount of liquidity before that, but, you know, my father, who's the chairman now, he being the true entrepreneur that he is, he wanted to put the money back into Marico. So he said, there's no point in doing, going to other asset classes or into equity. And that's the time I came to him and I told him that, listen, why do you want to put all your eggs in one basket? Why not look at diversification? Before this liquidity event, I actually was very keen on doing some small investing on my own. And before the whole thing, the whole startup space became as sort of sexy as it is today. So he saw that in me, and luckily for me, he believes in being a pioneer and doing things in doing new things. And he had, it wasn't that easy, but because I had a gentleman who was the M&A of Marico, and he was on his way out. And so along with him, both of us actually started investing. And that's when my father had faith that fine, these guys are onto something and there's potential out here, because the kind of investments, the initial investments we made were actually, it panned out that we did things that we understood. We did a lot of what we understood and what we know. And so that gave him some sort of conviction that fine, there's these guys are onto something, and there is potential here. And slowly but surely, I think, we got our toes wet, as they say, And, you know, we started doing a lot more sort of initially we were doing VC funds. So, you know, I'm not a PE VC from a PE VC background or from an investment background. So I'm more of an operator. But, you know, we got that perspective, you know, meeting the funds, meeting the entrepreneurs, seeing what's out there and understanding the ecosystem, understanding what is the term sheet, what is the shareholder agreement, what spaces to get into, understanding the entrepreneur. So that was the journey that that began. And then we formed an asset allocation strategy where we did 80 into public and 20 into the unlisted. And again, we had a multifamily office like a Servin or an Entrust. Sort of, you know, do that, or do the entire public markets for us. And we did the unlisted part of it. So that's where the journey began.
Sure. And what kind of startups have you primarily invested in on the unlisted side?
Sure. So we've done a mix, Ritu. So, you know, initially it was funds. So we did a whole bunch of tech funds and the consumer funds. And then, you know, later on when we're more confident, we did stuff that's consumer forward. So things that we understand better. So, you know, where it's in our own backyard with the consumer businesses that we own. So, you know, we've done across multiple stages. We've done something like Nykaa, which is a sort of, you know, vertical into personal skincare products, you know, personal care products. And, you know, through that, I mean, we did Nykaa. We've done a whole host of other consumer deals. We've done a beer company, a mattress company, a health foods company. Now we're into edtech. So it's been a mixture. And I think over the years also, it's been a 6-year journey now. And sort of, you know, it's now that we've found our sweet spot. So it wasn't always like that. We've made our own sort of mistakes along the way where we did things that were outside of our comfort zone. So, you know, things like we don't understand the whole medical space of, you know, the you know, medical trials and, you know, drug trial companies. So we've done some investments around that or into deep tech, which we don't really understand and appreciate. So that's when we came back to our core and said that, listen, we understand consumers. So let's focus on what we know and what we can appreciate. And, you know, so it's not just about the return. Of course, the most critical thing is getting the financial return, but you want to be a part of the journey. And it's a long journey, right? With the investment, it's an 8-10 year horizon. So you want to be there through and through. And depends on the high touch, low touch, mid touch with the entrepreneur. But as long as you can appreciate the journey, as long as you can understand where they're going, I think it's very enriching as well. It's of course, it is a financial return at the end of the day, but it's a whole host of other things that come along with that. And because we have another sort of operating entities, you can add value back to the operating entities also with the insights that you get, and vice versa. Even with the Marico, you can give so much perspective to the entrepreneur. So I think it works both ways.
Sure. No, that is great. And it's also good to see that, you know, you take so much personal interest in D2C kind of brands and more consumer facing brands. You know, they always know that there is somebody they can reach out to, which often sometimes, you know, in a VC world, it's very hard to figure out, you know, which is the right fund for them. So thanks for sharing that, Rishabh. Let me come to Benifer. Benifer, welcome. And, you know, I've been noticing the Ray Patni family office for a long time. And I understand that, you know, you were one of the early movers into the whole startup space when it came to tech investments and understanding that, you know, startups could be a great space or an asset class where family funds could be deployed into and build assets instead of just invest in assets. So, you know, how is it that family offices, and I mean, since you've already done a course of about 8 years with these investments, what has the learnings that have come to you as a family office about working with startups? How do you feel that startups today can you know, work more closely or can work better or can see an enhanced investments going forward from family offices?
Great. So yes, we've been at it for a while, like you mentioned, and we've had some hits, we've had some misses. But I just think that the whole ecosystem has really come a long way from where we started off eight odd years ago. The systems evolved. I would think that startups and what families generally look for, what got us excited about the whole ecosystem was just first the drive of these entrepreneurs to kind of deliver. And when we met a lot of these, I mean, till now, the last count that we have is we've crossed about 1,050 companies that we've seen so far at least from the time that we've been recording, you know, on a simple note. And our startup founder age group has been varied, you know. So we've seen a bunch of startups also coming from the very mature, you know, the second innings kind of promoters. And then we've seen a bunch of startups who've actually come from a very younger mindset kind of promoters. So we've engaged ourselves in both. But what the first most critical thing for a family office to kind of get into this ecosystem or even look or support is this ecosystem is to kind of find a level playing field with the particular promoter or, you know, entrepreneur. So the first thing is, how do we perceive that particular entrepreneur and whether we see synergies in what we can add as value to these to their business and to their strategy, and whether there is alignment on that count. Once there is an established alignment found, then we actually go across and see the other parameters, which is typically the way we would like to see startups, at least at Raise, that we look at a certain cutoff. We look at some, so we don't look at anything at concept stage. We look at it with a little proof of concept. It might be very low in a few lakhs of revenue, etc. But we do that. We've also, over time, each family will be unique. So they will like to pick on a theme which or a strategy which they would be finding core to their understanding. So at Ray, for example, we've picked tech through the venture funds that we've invested. And that is led by a separate set of professionals, the venture fund heads. At Ray, we picked two, three themes which have evolved over the years. So first we started with consumer because we thought that was an easier segment and we could add value. We've led on to fintech. And then we now, off late for the last 2 years, we've been looking at digital content. So these are outline parameters that we've set, you know, towards some of these startup ventures. And like I said, that it's more important to find a level playing field where we can add value and the entrepreneurs also open to ideation.
Sure. No, that's wonderful. And particularly on the tech side, what sectors would there be that you would now be looking at, particularly post the pandemic?
So we've closely started working last 2 years, like I mentioned, on the other fund where we were doing AI and a lot of IoT. IoT, I think, is also taking up a lot of, you know, attention now, because it requires a certain amount of analytics to kind of fall into place to set a predictive analysis on what we can do ahead. So that space is gaining more traction. And with the pandemic, of course, there is health tech also, which has taken over. So you see a lot of innovation happening there. You've seen a lot in the past 6 months, and that's also a space that is exciting.
Sure. Thanks, Manifer. Let me come to Rajmohan. Rajmohan, you know, Interest has been one of the pioneers in family offices in India, wherein, you know, a multi-family office, which was probably a very, very early concept back in 2010-11, you know, was when you started working in this area. So what have you observed? What trends have you observed in terms of how HNIs want to react or want to invest in startups? You know, what kind of risks are they looking to take, and where are they risk averse when it comes to working with startups? And over a course of journey, where do you think family offices can add value in a startup operationally from a governance perspective, or from, you know, helping the entrepreneur build contacts or you know, have some kind of a support system which they might need in the early days of the business? So what are your views on this?
So thank you for having me here. And so I would put it this way. So I've seen the private equity industry evolve since 2007. In fact, the first fund, that time I was not in Interest, I was with Kotak. So that was the first private equity fund which was launched. And it was more of a push, okay, than a pull. Okay, so it was basically sold as a kind of a new concept. And private equity is completely a new area which generated a lot of interest among investors. But if you look at some of the funds, and it's very, very early, like the first biotech fund was there, then the sector agnostic fund was there, the first PE fund. So some of them, in fact, performed well. Some of them did not do that well. And investors didn't have a great kind of an experience. And these are very, very early days. So it was not evolved at all. But if you look at India as a market, there are only pockets of investors who are willing to take risk. Okay, and these pockets are clearly investors who have had some taste of success. Okay, either they would have, done some exits, or they would have made some, kind of a windfall kind of a monies out of some of their, stocks. And thereon, their allocation, they'll make a kind of a small allocation in terms of investments. Where we see a lot of interest is the second or a third gen. Okay, when, like for example, typically Rishabh, what he spoke, is just, so Rishabh has taken interest when it comes to Marico in terms of, so he has taken interest and he said, saying that, why don't you invest? The same, thought process is there everywhere. If you look at Mr. Pai's, Mohandas Pai's sons, so they have a private equity fund. And likewise, you see a lot of youngsters who have come in and they have set up funds, and also they are looking at taking risks. Okay, but if you look at the mature investors, I would say basically people who have really made the money, okay, themselves, they are not very comfortable in terms of this asset class. Okay, so typically they are still contemplating, and they are not there in terms of the startup kind of an investing. But what we believe is the panelists say, it has come of age. It's like, it's changing. Okay, every day I keep receiving, like for example, just before this call, I had a call with an investor. He's saying that things are happening, Mumbai Angels, things are buzzing. In fact, why don't we look at an opportunity to invest? Okay, and there are a lot of new opportunities which we should evaluate and invest. Now, from our side, what we do is, we just don't, we are not just passive investors. Okay, when we invest money, we are completely involved with the company. Okay, when we say we are involved, in terms of the management. We are part of, we don't take a board seat, but we are board observers in most of these investments. We track the performance. We help them with strategies. In fact, we give them connects in terms of wherever there is a business connect which is involved, we connect them. In terms of governance, like basically we are very, very focused on the governance part, okay, and extremely in the diligence part also. So we are extremely focused on that. I think an organization like us, being involved in the firm is always great for an investor, because his interests are completely protected, and he can rest in peace, meaning in terms of he can clearly saying that there's somebody who's looking at it every day. Okay, and if there is any problem, okay, then we get in. Okay, like for example, there are investments where there have been some issues where we have gotten, we have spent hours together in terms of with the promoters, with the, the private equity investors. We have brought a kind of a resolution to these investments and we have kicked it off. Okay, we have rejigged the entire thing. So there's a lot of value add which a family office can do with respect to the investments. And we have had great experiences in this.
Sure, totally agree there. And I think what you've made is a great point is that, family offices can jump in where operationally they are required.
Absolutely.
And for a startup and actually handhold the startup wherever they feel that, their presence could help the business, which I think is a good thing. You don't need to be completely 100% involved, but at the time when it is critical for a startup at a certain juncture, one can be involved, and therefore it's a win-win on both sides.
Yes.
So Manish, let me ask you this. If a family office or a high net worth individual comes to you and says they want to make an investment, what kind of typically rate of return is it that they are looking on their investment, to say that, okay, this is what we expect? And then typically, even if you're looking at startups, because the whole agenda today is to see how family office and startup connection can be built, then how do you sort of pick up your startups, or what kind of startups do you then pick up to understand, that this would just be right for the HNI or the family that I'm representing in this startup. So, you know, how does the whole process work? And of course, as I was probably asking Rajmohan the same thing, do you also encourage participation of the family in the startup business as well?
Sure. I think great question. I think, Ritu, the reason of a family office wanting to invest in a startup can be very different. So even two brothers in the same family may have very different reasons for investing in a startup. So I think that becomes the most important part when a family comes to us to assess why they want to, you know, be in the startup space. And I think one of the key areas that, you know, are key functions of a multifamily office, Ritu, is also education, you know, helping the family understand the space better, because we are not distributors of any product. We don't have any of our products. So you have to handhold them through the process of why do you want to have an asset class? And I think once you have an asset allocation for a family of in place and a risk pool in place, that's the time when you educate that family of what and why should you be investing in this space. Now, on the return part, I think return is a very personal question that gets asked to us. For some families that we talk to, for them, a return is the only reason they are investing, that, oh, I hope to get a return of maybe 16, 17, 18% kind of a return. But for others, the reason may be completely different. He's saying, okay, I may just get an equity return, a listed equity return, but the kind of experience I'll go through by investing into a startup and understanding how a startup scales up, what are the issues, how does that asset class behave vis-a-vis the other listed asset class, that's also a learning, that's also a return for that family. Now, just linking it back to what Rishabh said, you know, when they made their initial investments, that was an important cost he paid to learn about how investing in the startup space. So I think initially when somebody comes to us, our talks in most cases with them to understand is to get the asset allocation in place, make them understand what a risk premium is all about, because ultimately we are all wanting to have that identification of risk premium from that asset class, and then understand why they want to be in that space. And just, you know, interfacing with an earlier question of yours, the intent of that family may be very different. Intent of Rishabh was to start something separate from the main business and maybe set up an expertise inside the family office to invest in that space. Usually most family office will start from in the domains which are aligned to their main business. So which are maybe, you know, second level, second circle or third circle in that space. That they will do directly because they may have the wherewithal to help those families. And as you also, you know, put out very clearly that help is very essential at some part of time. So the intent might be just to maybe able to expand the zone of operations of the main business, of the main family business, and invest in that space. The second circle is unrelated investment. So if Rishabh was to do a deep tech or an AI or an IoT kind of an investment, you know, that may not be something where he can add value at all. I mean, he may not even want to have a board observer seat in that kind of an investment. But in investments where he can add value, he will definitely want to be there. Do remember, venture capitalists are usually financial investors. You know, they may not come from the same domain as what family offices do come around in that. And the case of Binayfer, I mean, their experience in technology helped them to understand initially. And since I know the family office from quite a long number of years, but yes, they've expanded slowly and slowly in other areas as well, which have nothing to do with technology as well in some cases. So returns is only one of the discussions they have. I think we handhold them through the process of understanding how should you start direct versus fund investments, pros and cons of each, and what is benefited for that particular one family. And finally, being active or non-active, I think the question depends upon our ticket size as well. If I'm just putting $500,000, frankly, I can't expect to be even get a board observer in some of these larger rounds. But I think if the family can definitely add value, the promoter or the founders of the startups are very happy to, I think, keep them on board and help out in those processes. I think that's the way. So return becomes an outcome of multiple factors. It's not a standalone figure of 16. Frankly, out of your 20, 30 investments, 10 will go bust. And as Raj, you know, clearly said, some have already gone bust before he sees returns in his portfolio. But that's the way it is. It's part of an education that we have to provide. So return, yes, they want to have at least maybe 500, 600 basis points above the listed equity returns. That's the ballpark theoretical figure, I think, which people do run with these days.
Sure. No, you're right over there to say that, you know, education is very important. So, I mean, I think given the fact that, you know, today, on one side, there is somebody who's running a family business, and they want to also invest in startups, which could actually at some point of time be critical for their own business also. You know, so I mean, what Rishabh said, that they invest in FMCGs, and at some point of time, you know, that startup might actually become part of Marico only. So Rishabh, do you see such situations coming up wherein, you know, the R&D, which would otherwise have happened in your own organization, now you're working with startups over there, and you see that product becoming part of the main Marico or one of the Marico investments?
Sure. No, thanks. Thanks, Ritu. It's an interesting question, because a lot of corporates will be thinking like that, and a lot of family-owned businesses will be thinking like that. So it depends. I mean, I'll give you our context, and then I'll give you the other context as well. We're a publicly limited company. And, you know, one of the reasons why we have good valuations is because of corporate governance. So today, if I'm a related party and I'm doing some business and I'm an investor in a business that's doing business with Marico, a minority shareholder can always come up and ask us, saying that, you know, what is this business that you guys are doing together, you know? So, I mean, we'll always do things at an arm's length transaction, and we discourage any related party transactions. So from a Marico construct, we will not do it. In fact, we discourage it. We clearly discourage doing anything where there's work to do with any of the investee companies. I mean, it'll so happen that you know, Marico would be working with a large sort of skincare vertical like Nykaa, but that's nothing to do with our investment in that business. So, but again, that's because we're public limited company, and you know, corporate governance is very high. But in other sort of family owned, privately held businesses, of course, you know, Munisha and I were on a panel some time back, and we were talking to this one gentleman, and where it's a privately held organization, and his engagement with the portfolio companies was very high, you know, and there's a lot of linkages. So I think it depends on who it is, and if it's a public versus a privately held. I think there's a lot more room for collaboration in a privately held business, and when those same promoters go out and invest in startups or PE or VC.
Yeah. If I may just add, Ritu, one point here. Right now, the corporate venture teams are also becoming important for many corporates, especially in their aligned businesses or correlated businesses. So whenever actually this is happening lately, that when you go to a family office and you showcase a deal which fits into the family's profile, sometimes they, you know, they always tell us, you know, we may not be able to do it, but maybe our CV arm may be interested, because this may be a strategic investment going forward. That's also what we are seeing, you know, happening in this space.
Sorry, just to add to that, Ritu, that's exactly what's happened here with us as well, where, you know, with Marico, they did, I mean, it's in the media, but, you know, they did something in the male grooming space. They acquired a business called Beardo. And, you know, for us as a family office, you know, we would like to be a bridge between the corporate and the startup world. So we give them the right of first refusal. So, you know, first we'll see, okay, is this of interest to Marico? And if it's of interest to Marico, that's great. Let them take the deal, but we will not participate. And if it's not of interest to them, then we'll look at it. So this way we give exposure to the corporate in terms of looking at the deal. And, you know, if not, then we'll look at it.
Sure. Yeah, that's an interesting point of view. Manafer, let me ask you this. And since you particularly invest in tech startups, digital transformation has become, you know, a very important aspect. And family businesses are the ones, and SME businesses are the ones who need this digital transformation. Do you see some kind of connection here between the startup world, particularly startups who are providing more enterprise tech kind of solution-based program or product for businesses? Do you see an opportunity for family businesses to invest in such startups who can help them, their business as well, to transform, and also that can become a norm in the industry? So let's say if it's the, let's say the chemical industry. Now, if there is one startup which invests and comes and, you know, does a digital transformation for one business, one large business in the chemical industry, then it can become like a benchmark for the same startup to go and actually go out to the entire chemical industry for them. And one, that business who was one of the early movers who took this service or took this product could be the investor for such startup. Do you see such situations, collaborations happening in the coming times with digitization being the norm happening in the startup space?
See, in the startup space, especially in the tech, when it's related to enterprise tech, etc., a few things which come relevant is what is the nature of the business the family is in? And secondly, is how much funding will that enterprise actually require to go on, you know, to become a very meaningful play? Now, our observation on this is that sometimes some of these early digital plays come in and, you know, take the earlier checks because they want the patient capital till the time that they are developing, you know, some of the strategies or trying to mix match and find the right blend for what works and what doesn't. Yeah. Once they've achieved their product as a mix of what they want to deliver to the market, our experience is that they're happier going to the venture funds. One is because they can cross-pollinate on their networks. That's one. Two is there are specific funds in the industry which actually nurture and crossbreed some of these very, very actively. And that's where the disconnect between a family only want, you know, kind of trying to handhold an enterprise versus a whole ecosystem trying to handhold an enterprise. That is clearly there, right? So I would think that the both routes are possible. It's just also in tech and any kind of automation, the kinds of capital that is required for building up a whole strata of, you know, a product which is very, very viable is immense. Sometimes families might not be very keen to kind of go that route. Another important thing is that at least for families, and I think Raji can add to that, what we've seen is that at least, you know, when we want to invest in certain companies or put our time, energy, effort, or ideation or networks behind a certain name of an entrepreneur, we want to see, and we are naturally entering at a pretty early stage, we want to see a certain percent of ownership in the company. And there is also sometimes a little bit of disconnect in the tech world of how much they would want to let go at such an early stage. So I think these are two things which once they find their merit, they can grow. Otherwise, the venture ecosystem is something which is more apt for that kind of growth.
Sure. Manish, just to add to what Binayfar said, do you at all receive requests from ultra HNIs, you know, who find that their business was probably made in a more traditional space and today they want to modernize, they want to be part of the new age sort of businesses, and therefore the interest to invest in startups and therefore the interest to be partnering with startups is something that is cropping up, and how can we now maximize this is the real question. And I think for family businesses, it's going to be extremely critical. And of course, starting with the large family businesses, you know, Rishabh classically said that this was something that they, you know, he, it was something at the back of his mind to see that, you know, whether they could actually potentially help a lot of D2C or direct consumer facing businesses to actually grow their business through their you know, whatever setup that they had in a large enterprise that they were running. So do you see such possibilities going forward, and that might actually increase or accelerate family businesses to or family offices to invest more in startups?
Yeah, no, very true. You're absolutely right, Ritu. The reasons of, as I said, investing in a startup can come from varied reasons, but let's take an example of a family that we are currently working on the governance side. They're in the cement business, a very small scale cement business. The next gen is absolutely not interested in that business at all, because they're all, both the brothers are, you know, educated abroad. They love the new age tech, you know, those kind of innovation techs. They have been born and brought up in that space because they're, you know, a very early age, they left India. So in that case, it becomes very important for the promoter of that family business, you know, or the karta of the family, as we call them in Indian, in Indian space, to understand what they are wanting. And hence, he came in with a request saying that, you know, can we seed certain businesses or startups in the space my next gen is interested into? And that falls on our shoulders as a multifamily office as well, because part of our job is mentorship. So while you're defining a family governance or family constitution, part of that job also falls to us to mentor the next gen. So you do get requests of, you know, why don't you spend time with my kids, understand that space. And sometimes, you know, the kids maybe sometimes can't talk to their first gen so easily. There is a respect which is, you know, genuinely there, but they do open up to people like us. So that request does come in. And second part, which you, I think, rightly mentioned, is that the family business is in a very, I will not call it old age businesses, because there are many businesses will continue. But in most cases, it may be a disruptive space where they see that they're getting slowly disrupted. Yeah. So their business, their business environment is changing. So they really want to de-risk. And that's the place where the family office starts then playing its role of understanding, okay, now, you know, we've got five, it takes years. It doesn't take 1 year, but it takes years to, you know, get the family execute, get their personal capital out slowly by having different events and those kind of stuff, and not put everything into their business, and slowly create those second or third rungs of their family business. And Ritu, it's a very old saying, when we, you know, people like us meet together, that, you know, a family business has to go and become a business family. While a family business may have only one business, when you are a business family, you may have multiple businesses and you may actually become sort of mini conglomerates. That's the reality of life. But next gen, yes, they do come often to us and say, you know, I don't want to be in my dad's cement business or rugs business for that matter, but we want to do something else. The daughter-in-laws may come with a different set. You know what? We want to do something in this impact investment startup space. So can I do something in the rural housing startups or rural finance startups in that space? So I think the reasons are multitudes, but as I said, we have to make them understand of what they're trying to enter into. And these requests will happen. And, you know, wealth transition is only one part of it. When you transition a family from one generation to another, the whole nuance of understanding what a family business should be may be changing completely because of difference in backgrounds, education. I think that will become a bigger challenge now. So a very important question for that part, Ritu.
Absolutely. Raj, what do you say about what Vinish had just mentioned, you know, going from a family business to a business family? That's an interesting take from what he just said. So how do you sort of see this from this transition? Where does startup investment fit? And, would you rather, I mean, given from what learnings you might have had from other markets also, markets like China, Europe, US, How do you see a better participation or an increased percentage of startup funding coming from family offices?
No, I'm sure that what Munish said is absolutely right in terms of when you're looking at family business to a business family, it's a transition. It's just not transition. It's a transition of your thought process. It's a transition of the family itself. Okay, right from across generations, people have to sink in terms of this thought. And typically what happens is not everybody in the second gen or the third gen, it's not required that people are extremely keen in terms of probably diversify, get into newer businesses. What happens is invariably, the kids have seen, grown with the parents. Okay, and they would have seen a lot of dinner table discussions on the firms, what they run. Okay, and so typically there is a lot of bias towards the business, what they know very well. Okay, now anything which is tech, which is deep tech, which is AI, these are completely new areas. Okay, now I see a lot of these areas, these investments are coming from the younger generation who understand the space quite well. See, it's very important when you are investing in a startup. It is not just, investing in a fixed deposit or a mutual fund or something like that. It's not an instrument where you're investing. It's a business. Okay, so when you're investing in a business, understanding is very, very important. Okay, and when you're sitting in a board meeting, when there are multiple challenges going through in a business, you need to understand what is happening in the board meeting, what people are trying to even bring it up. Okay. If you don't understand that at all, you'll be completely all at sea. And even if your family office, you're appointed a family office and even a family office person, like rightly Manish said, saying that everyone can't understand all the businesses, right? So it is very, very important. So that is why I feel saying that the trend what I see is investments are happening purely based on the understanding of the business. So typically, if you look at somebody who's in the tech industry, okay, understands tech very well. Okay, so his idea, his interest, and nobody looks at startup investing. See, if you're looking at investment as a vehicle, then you'll go to a fund. Okay, you will go to a fund. It's a vehicle which carries multiple companies, and you are just bothered about return. But whereas if you're investing in a company, then that's not why you're investing. You're investing because you like the business, you see a upside in the business, and you see a trend in the business, and that's why you invest. Okay, and for that, a deep understanding of that business is very, very important. Otherwise, just investing will not give you the satisfaction. And number two is, if you're most of them invest because they would want to participate in the management, they would want to mentor, they would want to contribute, they want to value add to the business. So where will I value add? If I understand the business, I will value add. Otherwise, I'll be going and sitting just like that in a meeting without any value add. So it's very, very biased towards, I feel startup investing is happening completely biased towards what industry I like, what I believe in, and what I can add value to.
Let me ask you this question. Given the fact that, you know, family businesses need to change, it's much faster than, you know, probably a lot of other businesses out there. Do you see at some point of time, you know, the funding that family businesses may pull in India for startups? And I mean, I'm not just talking in metro cities and very large businesses, but I'm talking like this becoming a thought, like deep down India, you know, and wherein this could be happening regionally. Do you feel maybe 5 years down the line, VCs and family business office funding might be competing with each other?
I feel it will happen because, see, as I said earlier, India is a very evolving market. Okay, and we have seen last about 10 years is when the family office and the family offices have gained some kind of an importance, and we are seeing all this action in the last about 5 years. And I'm sure, like what you're saying, will happen definitely. And in the next 5 years, you will see a totally new generation of people coming in, okay, and start looking at private equity investment or venture investing, you know, from a completely new perspective. Okay, and if you look at the millennials, look at investing completely differently from the earlier generation. I'm sure that will happen. I'm sure that will happen.
Can I add one point, Ritu, here? I think just a small number, Mr. Chris Gopalakrishnan shared in a couple of places he has spoken, is that he said out of the ultra high net worth wealth in India, right now only 1% of that wealth is being invested into startups. So that's the challenge. Whereas globally, if you look at Europe and more of these markets, I think almost 10% of the investments are happening from family offices. And also another point I think which we discussed is that VC is only one part of the investments. There is private equity at the late stage as well. He, I think, clearly mentioned that the moolah being created or the profits being generated in the late stage is completely being taken away by offshore capital. So, in the theme of making sure the money also sustains in India and then powers more innovation, you need to have larger family offices guided towards private equity as well, the growth stage funding, you know, which will actually allow these companies to make more profits and give that profit back to Indian investors, which can again be plowed back. Because right now, if I remember correctly, I think 90% of the growth capital comes from offshore funds or offshore related entities. So I think that's one space where we definitely need to grow and grow with proper education. I think that goes without saying, as Rajmohan was saying.
No, actually, why?
The ecosystem evolving here. Sorry. So I mean, what Raj and Manish said and Binayfer, Rishabh, please add here. Do you see a complete ecosystem? Now VC is a complete ecosystem. So there are, you know, VCs who would typically give a pre-series A, and then different VCs will be giving a series B, yeah, and different VC will be giving a series D, and then the private equity will start participating. We don't see anything like that. It's a very flat layer right now for family offices when it comes to startup investing. Do you see these layers being formed in family office funding also to invest in other businesses, which is where this the growth might be very large for startups to look funding for family offices. From my experience right now, probably, you know, when a startup is looking for a funding, he would typically go to an angel investor, then to a VC, and then come to a family office. Now, how do you reverse a situation and say that, you know, and that is how you'll get good assets at the end of the day, when you will, everybody approaches you and you get to choose the best startup that you really want.
No, so actually, to your point, the ecosystem is evolving. And I think to the previous discussion, it is going to become extremely relevant for family offices and family, treasuries to actually start looking at a little mature stage investments. So just to take off from Rishabh's example, very early stage investors in Nykaa came in and kind of invested. Now, if you ask families today whether they are geared enough to take up a fresh investment in Nykaa, maybe other than the ones who are doing a follow-on to manage their stake, the answer could be no at this stage, right? Because the stock has already kind of gone through its movement. Sorry to take that example, Rishabh. But what I'm trying to drive towards is, there might be a lot of meat still on a deal which can be taken off instead of being taken off by a XYZ US-based firm or a, you know, offshore Asian entity or, you know, whichever way you look at it. Because there is, when it actually goes into its mature phase, right, when you have an established, when your risk return matrix is very, very much in your favor versus to where it was when families like ours put, whatever behind these early stage capital, I think Indian families are still to evolve in that direction. That's point number one. Secondly is that unlike earlier times, see, entrepreneurs who built businesses, made it listed entities, etc. Now in India, we haven't really seen, I mean, even if you see the latest conglomerate who's getting deals every week that we see off in the market, how many Indian families or Indian houses have actually partnered in that growth, right? When we see, UAE-based families and UAE-based treasuries, like even very mature funds, PE firms from US participate or wanting to take a pie of that growth, right? Why don't we see a Paytm, Vijay taking a stake there? Or why don't you see any of the newer age monies, a Flipkart guy taking a stake there, right? So there is still that, glass walls on, it's my business, it's my company, and, I will choose where we go to. Whereas in the, they lose the thought process that India wealth should be growing India's wealth instead of India wealth growing offshore wealth. I think that maturity is still to come in. And that can only come in when there are professionals in between who actually disengage this emotional content of a business attachment versus a prudent investor, mandate. So I think that ecosystem will evolve. And I think slowly and steadily from the early stage, you will see some of these companies wanting to offload to some of the larger families as well here.
But here, what I would like to say is this: when you're looking at ticket sizes, if you just look at the overall pie, which is getting managed by either a family office or the family treasury, or the family themselves. Okay, if you just look at anywhere between 4,000-5,000 crores. Okay, I'm talking about the higher side. I'm just giving you 10% is what anybody is looking at investing in private equity. Okay, 10% is a good sum. Okay, or a 15% max, which is about 500 to 600 crores is what we are talking about. Now, if a kind of a very, very late stage kind of an investment, okay, will involve anywhere between about 50 to 60 or even $100 million kind of a ticket check size. I don't think any family in India today, except for one or two or three maximum, will not be able to cut those checks. Whereas if you look at sovereign funds, if you look at endowments, if you look at family offices abroad, they have got the capacity to cut 100 million check for an investment. Okay. And that is why I'm saying it is a journey. Okay. We have started this journey. It is going to take a while for this journey to reach there. Okay. There's no shortcut in this because wealth has to grow. Okay. And wealth will have to multiply for people to really cut those checks. Okay. When they know saying that, yes, we have enough money, the wealth has grown. And automatically this 10% or a 15% or a 20%, that itself, the pie will grow to a substantial sum where you can cut these checks. Till such time, it's not hesitation. It's basically, it's about risk management. Okay, whether I can really cut that kind of check and still stay grounded. It is very, very tough. It's not easy.
Sure.
The only solution being... This
gentleman was asking a question. Who wanted to add? Somebody wanted to add something?
No, I was just saying that unless you start pooling of assets. So, you know, today we are actually seeing in India, earlier everything was pre-series A, seed investments, and, you know, maybe series B. Now funds being launched in India, which are saying we will be in series B and C, which is pre-growth space. As we speak, there are filings happening as we speak. I think that's the first stage we are getting into. And pooling is the only way.
Pooling is
able to. There is no individual. I think, frankly, all of us know five large family offices who can cut a 100 crore check today, single investment. There are actually some 5-6 of them, arguably. But in case you do want to invest a 1,000 crore investment, there can still be a pooling vehicle involved which can actually channelize this. And absolutely, as Binayfar rightly said, the risk return is very different than a private equity in the growth space. So it lies somewhere between the listed equities and the venture capital space. So when you actually, asset allocate for a family, you allocate that kind of risk as well. Or what part of the private market you want to be part of. So I think pooling is the only way we'll be able to get this thing going.
Yeah, I mean, had there been that kind of investments in family offices, you would have actually cut a check for Jio by pooling it.
Even after pooling, we can't cut those checks, I'm pretty sure about it.
So we've got a question from Harshit. We can probably give him an audio. He's actually asked quite a few questions. So Harshit, if you would want to ask it yourself. Please unmute before you ask.
Hello.
Yes, we hear you.
Yeah, so I would like to know how certain businesses, medium scale businesses who are a large distributor, in a large distribution space, example, who are into a pharmacy business or who have a specific distribution of a specific brand, and the kind of disruption by e-commerce and the Jio coming into place. So how could family offices help them to be relevant even today? So they are relevant from past 20 years or something and they are having their own margins all set. But big players like Flipkart and Jio coming in, they would have a direct supply chains to the manufacturers. So how could this gap be bridged in order for the medium scale, family business and large scale to be relevant in this disruption?
So who wants to take it up?
I think I'm equipped to. I'll add there. We have one business which is few businesses. Munish will know, and so will Rishabh in this space. What I want to, and one of them is in pharmacy as well. So I'll just draw from that from the board meeting that we just attended a couple of days ago. The learning is, keeping not drifting completely towards either side. The learning is to find a balance, what we call in some context an omni-channel, which is that you keep growing your base or your distribution at the ground level as you've been doing in the past. You might have to do it at a little faster pace than what you've done it in the past. At the same time, you use delivery models, etc., which are more new age to get to the end consumer. That's one. And two would be to also, centralize some operations and kind of get, probably find hubs where you can, deliver some of these from. The answer is not to heavily discount, because that is something that we have been discouraging most of our companies to do. The answer of any value of a business lies in the EBITDA. It lies in revenues and profitable revenues in the end of it all. So what we would urge you to do is that at the cost of losing market share, you should ideally maintain some part of that on a consistent basis, because trends will come and trends will go, but discounting also will come and go, like we're seeing in the telecom world today, or we've seen the farm easies and the net meds and all those kind of worlds. But I think keeping an omni-channel business is the answer, according to me, to this, Harshit.
Rishabh, what is it that you are advising your distributor networks? You know, obviously there is a disruption in the distribution setups, and today, of course, you know, there are huge number of businesses across states, across regions, of large distributors, you know, and they don't want to erode their family wealth by just putting more into physical distribution. So what is it that they
Sure. I think the model is changing, and, you know, Binayfa answered that question really well, but just a little bit more on FMCG distribution that we are seeing is that, you know, you have these distributors and who've been doing this business for years and years and through generation to generation with as a family business. And that whole model is being disrupted now, you know, on multiple fronts. One is that the new generation doesn't actually want to work out there because they think it's like a very old school fuddy-duddy business, and they don't want to deal with such manpower, and, you know, it's completely unorganized. You're at the mercy of large corporates. So I think it's changing, and each one has to find his or her spot, you know, based on their strengths. And I mean, again, what I'm saying is very theoretical on one end, but as Binayfar said, it's, you know, the Medlifes or the net meds and the pharmacies of the world are there, but a lot of what's happening right now is just pure digitization. So of course the omnichannel route is there, but how do you work with new age companies, new age brands? There is so much venture capital coming into early stage as well, some of these new age brands need these distribution folks. And so, you know, if they can pivot and pilot or pilot new projects, you know, based on not legacy but based on new age, something like that will actually also help them, because there's a dire need for this, for FMCG or for pharma, to actually engage with the distribution setup from a new age perspective. You don't have to have 10,000 stores under your under your belt. You can easily have a lot smaller sort of setup and still pilot a few models and see how it scales. This way you don't land up spending too much money, and you'll end up testing and seeing what can work, what won't work.
Sure. So, Manish, this was exactly what I was referring to earlier. You know, there are pockets of businesses in India today which will, get disrupted so badly, and their entire wealth might just slide off till somebody comes and does something about them. So, you know, in fact, this is one question I've been talking to VCs for the longest time, that, you know, while we are creating one set of wealth, we are also destroying another set of wealth out there. Do you think family businesses, business offices might have an answer that these businesses can be saved, their wealth can be saved, it doesn't get eroded because of disruption, and whatever has been created can be used or probably multiplied in another direction?
So, Ritu, there are two parts to this reality. One part is that businesses run their own course, and business environments change without anything under your control. So there will be disruptions. Let's be open about it. Earlier, the disruption cycles were really long. You know, I've got an economist background. So, you know, when we look at it from an economist point of view, those cycles are now collapsing. So disruptions are happening faster. If you remember those days when your father said, I'm gifting you so many HLL shares, which I've held for the last 20 years, because they are the champions in FMCG. You can't say that now, because any stock which survives 5 to 10 years is a long time for that stock, because the businesses are getting disrupted. So on one hand, family businesses will get disrupted. So they have to be a bit more agile on understanding risk to their businesses. So the board meetings actually, so I was a mentor to one of the distribution companies, hyperlocal companies, last year. And frankly, the challenge for most old businesses is that whether you have to change, is something coming your way? Is that light at the end of the tunnel, or is that a train beaming down on you? So you have to constantly in every board meeting keep on, you know, ascertaining where your family businesses are, what is happening in the macro environment. And if you read annual reports, actually most of us have forgotten reading annual reports for many companies, but they actually talk about this as well. what are the risks they perceive? And sometimes you really read and understand they are not talking about what can go wrong in the business, what can change. So one is this economic change or disruption which is happening from that angle, and hence the need of making sure that your family wealth still continues to gain, and maybe that wealth is used to maybe set up new age businesses as well. So that's one part of it. And second part of it is, and this is to the gentleman's question as well, is that what is their function of their business? It's like Kodak. Kodak said, we are in the camera business. We are in the camera film business. No, they died, right? Today they're known as a chemical company and getting mandates from the US government. But if they said we are in the imaging business, so they would have gone, created digital cameras, maybe caught digital SD cards for that matter. But they had this very narrow thing of, I am a film camera company or a camera company. That the businesses have to come out of and say, okay, I'm in the distribution business. Doesn't matter if FMCG or it is anything. I have to send products from A to B. Now, I may have to change my ways of doing things because the new age companies require highly efficient systems to give delivery. And hyper delivery is a 2-hour delivery. I mean, Amazon Fresh and all these things. So I have to change my way of doing businesses. So yes, they will get disrupted, Ritu, and you have to constantly, as a family business owner, and this is the conversation we have, that what are the risks to the family business? And hence, because family wealth is an outcome of family business, Ritu, we keep forgetting that. If the family business is not doing well, family offices will not happen. I mean, they will not be able to accumulate wealth. So that's in one discussion which every business need to have and not just sit on laurels. Yeah, some businesses are so strong. I mean, FMCG is not going to go anywhere. So Rishabh can lie free, but you need to be getting newer products on the shelf. There is competition happening from one deodorant, which is saying I'm gas-free. I mean, I don't know the difference between the two, but theoretically speaking, yes, he is taking your market share. So you have to be constantly being agile to safeguard your business and keep on thinking, what can I add? What can I be better? And then interface with these new age so-called clients of yours and understand, what does Flipkart want? What does, what EasyBe, all these delivery companies, why are they say so successful? They're also making losses. And I'm sure this gentleman company is still making profits. But why are they under losses? So like you rightly said, money will come in and disrupt businesses. And yes, there will be some sad stories coming our way for sure, Ritu.
Sure. So, we have already overshot the time. So one thing.
Thanks a lot, Pam.
Yeah, you're welcome, Harshit. One thing I would want all of you, if you can sort of quickly give your last views on how can today businesses, instead of getting disrupted, come and be part of the family office and therefore save their wealth. Particularly, I understand slowdown times has given a very different perspective to all of us. So, if you can just share one thing that you think can becoming a family business office can help them to, I would not even say disrupted, it's more like destroyed, So how can you save your business from destruction? But not your business. Business might actually just go wealth from destruction and be put to use in another area.
So maybe
let's start with you, Rishabh, and for whoever would want to take this final round of questions.
Sure. Ritu, your question is that what can the family business do to make sure it doesn't get destroyed or disrupted?
No. So the question is that their business might be such that might still get destroyed, but the wealth doesn't. So, how can they make sure that their wealth is probably put to right use now so that they can, so that the whole thing doesn't fall apart. It doesn't become a house of cards and the whole thing doesn't go bust.
So Ritu, when a family realizes saying that the winds of change is, the direction is changing, okay, I think it's very, very important to sense that change. Okay, the minute you know saying that the wind is blowing in a different direction, and to realize that and to act swiftly, like what Munish said, is very, very critical. Okay, and if you've got the ability and if you've got the right, wherewithal to do it in terms of the next gen or the people who can think completely differently, I think it's a kind of a great thing. Now, if you're not able to, okay, if you're really, not thinking in a different direction, okay, and you know you'll get consumed, okay, in this disruption, then it's better to safeguard your business in terms of probably if you want to exit the business and reinvest it somewhere and to safeguard your wealth. Because what happens is once your business is destroyed, then you can't get back. Okay, at least you have the business running and you have cash flows coming in. Okay, and it purely depends on case to case basis. You can't generalize this, which is very, very tough. I think the family is very, very critical. They'll have to sit down, they'll have to discuss, they'll have to know their strengths and weaknesses. And if they know, saying that this is a weak point, then it's better not to venture into that and at least safeguard whatever is there. And that is what is critical.
Sure. Rishabh, you were saying something?
Sure. I think Mr. Rajmohan said it really well, but just if your business is getting sort of destroyed or disrupted, I think the first thing to do is, focus on your existing assets and, move it to something safer, or move the liquidity that you're getting from your existing business to a safer space, build up enough capital out there. And then, when you're ready, look at then starting a new business or, investing in, I would think even venture capital or private equities, that's not even the way to go, because the risk associated with that is significantly high. But just allocating capital and putting it in a safe space. So I'm sure Monish or Rajmohan out here would actually be better folks to answer this.
I can just quickly add to Rishabh's thing, and the most important role of a multifamily office or a family office advisor is to actually flag off risk to the family. And investment is only one part of the risk. And as I said earlier, that in case your business is on not very strong grounds, and the family is an entrepreneur, a gentleman or the lady is an entrepreneur, they understand the business is going down, but it's just that they are so close to it, it's a matter of heart and sentiments, that they just don't want to do anything about it. So I think once you realize it's on the downway path, I think it's very important to understand that family wealth or the family office needs to be a separate entity from your family business, legally speaking as well. Because this can actually, the family wealth can safeguard you through the downtimes and also provide you capital for new businesses. So our first advice to most families is sit down. If you don't have a family office, sit down, have a discussion between the key members of the family. If it's a large family, have a family business council meeting. Do those meetings and identify what can be the way outs. And I think besides disruption, Ritu, the other things which are destroying wealth is also family friction. So family friction in times of disruption are the worst case. I think you'll see court cases now just going up because of this disruption in whether where I told you so and I told you, I warned you, and these kind of things will happen. I think if you have a formal governance process, a constitution process, what happens when the business is going, I think that's very essential. As Rishabh said, venture investing can happen, but I think family business first has to save their business part of it. Only a family will remain. I think that's the best advice we give to most of our clients.
Jennifer, anything you want to add to it?
No, I think most points have been actually covered well. I would just think ideate, and simply put, and the end line I want to put, don't lever, because most families, try to put good money behind bad purposes. So what I want to say is that when you're in dire stress and when you're in more money to that is not going to do you any good. So, make sure that your lever is in control so that we are not making Netflix episodes of bad millionaire billionaires and stuff like that. That's all I want to say. Yeah,
I think well said there. So thank you very much to the entire panel. I think this was really interesting. You rightly said that the winds of businesses are changing things. The way we knew it, the way they were built, are not going to survive. So one thing is, of course, change. And secondly, I think Manish very nicely put it, that we need to be thinking family business and family office as two separate entities, and therefore be able to maximize what we can, create wealth and share this wealth, make more wealth out of your family office, and see what best can be done or newer ventures can be invested into. So thank you to the entire panel, to the panel, Rajmohan, Manish, Rishabh and Binayfer, for joining us here today. This talk is going to be on Facebook Live. If you have more questions, if you think you want to know something more about family office or taking an investment as a startup from family office, please keep on posting your questions there. We're going to urge all our speakers to answer them whenever time permits. And certainly, you know, next time when we meet, probably it will be out of the confines of the screen and really, you know, where we can actually shake hands, do high fives, and really talk about things in a one-to-one sort of person. So thank you very much for joining us.